This is Duke University.
And I really appreciated Patrick's last message about basically he's saying that instead of replacing the human, he wants to develop technology to augment the human. And in fact, that's what my lab, the Humans and Autonomy Lab, is all about. And these are all our funding agencies that we work for. And yes, there is an implicit joke in the name, but most of you don't get that joke. You have to ask somebody over 40 what the joke is. Okay, so what exactly do we do in the Humans and Autonomy Lab? We really look at, in this example, you see there's a human, in this case, flying a drone, but there's a computer in the middle, so the human is actually commanding the computer, and the computer is actually commanding the drone. But you could replace the drone in this picture with a driverless car, a manufacturing robot, a train, which I'll talk a little bit more about, or even a commercial airplane. All of these systems all are effectively robots in some way, shape, or form as soon as you start to introduce some levels of automation or autonomy. And the real question that my lab is trying to address is, well, how do you actually design these systems? What should the humans be doing? What should the autonomy or automation be doing? And what should they be doing together? And so in the case that you just saw with Patrick, God, you know, we are trying to help, we would help out in that system by helping figure out something we call function allocation. On that note, let me talk about some of the collaborative systems that we're doing research on right now. So the picture that you see on your left is, can you see the robot arm in the middle of an airplane console? So this project is called Alias. We just finished this with a company in Washington, D.C., Aurora Flight Scientists, also have an office in Boston. And the idea is that we're actually under a severe pilot shortage around the world. Not so much in the U.S., but in the rest of the world, we don't have enough pilots. We have a lot of planes, but they take two pilots to fly each plane. If we could take one of the pilots out, we would effectively double our workforce. So how do we do that? Well, we're basically turning the co-pilot of the plane into a robot. But in your mind, maybe you think of either a physical robot, or if you've seen airplane, you think of an inflatable robot, right? But in fact, what is it really going to look like? You don't need a humanoid robot to sit in the right seat of a plane. What you need is an arm to actually reach the actuation devices. And it actually has a speech component. It's like Alexa with an arm. And so, and in fact, if you go on YouTube, you can watch a video where the pilot tells the arm what to do. I need you to actuate the flap switch. I need you to take control because I want to go in the back and get a cup of coffee. And the arm responds in that way. So that's in the near-term future. So we're not talking about, you know, taking pilots out of the cockpit, all of them, just one of them. But of course, we are working in other transportation areas, drones, are us. That's kind of one of the things that my lab has become famous for. And, you know, we're very much working, this conceptual drawing above is a drone that can take you wherever you want to go. So the idea of the Jetsons, where you jump into the aircraft and you just tell it where you want to go and there's no pilot, that is certainly something that people are working on today. There are about a dozen companies worldwide who are trying to get drones on demand for your own personal transportation, passenger transportation services. And so we could imagine, what will this look like in 20 years if this does come to fruition? There are architects all over the world that are designing conceptual drawings of high rises where you will no longer have your balcony as much as you will have a drone pad. That is where your drone picks and takes you up, but in fact you don't own the drone anymore because Uber Elevate would like to believe that we're all going to call a drone from your phone to pick you up, so you don't actually have to own it because you won't be able to own it because it'll be too expensive, but it will be on an on-demand ride-sharing service. So don't hold your breath. These things aren't coming anytime soon, but they're in the works, and my lab we're working with NASA to help develop the concepts to go further. And as a shameless plug, Alex Stimpton and I, research scientist in the Humans and Autonomy Lab, we are working on an exhibit of drones in New York City. It's the first worldwide museum exhibit of drones that range from military drones all the way to these personal transportation drones. It opens in New York City in 1 week, 1 month, on the USS Intrepid. But we don't just work in airplanes. We've actually, if you were here last year about this time, you saw a bunch of crazy And this is a simulated driverless van with a screen on the front that's telling pedestrians when to walk or not to walk. And then we're running experiments to see how people interact with these cars as pedestrians, but to get it through the institutional review board, we had to have them on a lanyard to pull them out of safety's way in case they got into a little bit of trouble. And so this idea of, you know, driverless cars are coming. It's going to be a long time before you can have your own driverless car, jump into the back seat, tell it where to go, and then go to sleep. But you are going to have certain capabilities coming down the road. The nearest capability that's coming is basically a slow crawl capability that you will be able to engage in your car. I'm in a traffic jam, everything's moving really slowly. You hit the autopilot, for lack of a better word, function, and then it will do the crawling along in traffic by itself, and you will be expected to be on your cell phone. You will be expected to be sleeping, and you can do something else other than drive the car until you achieve a certain flow speed of traffic, and then control will be handed back off to you. So that's a more near-term technology. We're still pretty far away from letting you travel down the highway at high speeds, completely not paying attention, but that is the ultimate goal. So there's some other projects that we're working on in my lab. You heard Miroslav talk a little bit about one. One is, I call these decision theoretic models of human-robot supervision. You heard about the case where an operator is trying to detect whether or not a drone has been hacked. We've actually seen this in the real world. There was an RQ-4 drone basically stolen by the Iranians and forced down because of the vulnerabilities of GPS. So that has happened, and now, you know, we as a research community are trying to figure out how to do this, and we do think that this is one area of collaboration where humans really can help push along the technology solutions by helping algorithms reason. Computer algorithms still today have a lot of difficulty making sense of spatial maps, and so humans can be very helpful in that realm. Hi-Bae, raise your hand, Hi-Bae. Hi-Bae is going to be doing demonstrations of this at lunch in the very back room in the left corner, so go back there and check it out and see how good of a drone operator you are. But in a similar fashion, we've got another interface that you're going to be able to play with at lunch. Kaiji, Wansong, are you guys here? Lee Shao's here. She can help you. She'll be directing you. This is a project sponsored by the Jet Propulsion Lab, who does the Mars rovers. One of the problems that we see are both with Mars rovers and underwater submarines that they go away for a period of time. They're trying to navigate potentially an obstacle-dense field, and so operators have to develop some kind of trust in the algorithms, and how do they work with these algorithms? How do they plan? One problem that we know for sure in the real world is if an operator does not trust the system, they typically underutilize the systems, and then the system can't reach its full efficiency or capacity. So this game that we're playing, you'll be able to play, is really basically testing how well you trust a system given certain components of algorithms. So, and in both of these cases, we set up these simulation games. They're a lot like video games. They're fun to play. You're going to get a score, and you're going to want to try to beat the score of your buddy. So, Li Xiao, what's the best score on this game?
96.
Okay, 96 is the score to beat. All right, so, but, you know, it's fun for us to play these games, but one of the things that we do with these games, not just for fun, are in the background, we're actually structuring statistical models, something we call hidden Markov models, of how you interact with the game. And by developing these models, it tells us a lot about what's a good design strategy, what's a bad design strategy, so that we can actually understand this before we design and deploy a system. Another cool project that we're working on, we get to model and design command centers of the future. Very, very cool. This is a futuristic display where you're thinking about there's big wall screen displays, lots of information, maybe some operators who are individually managing certain elements of the overall big picture. You could imagine somebody for Amazon. Wouldn't it be great? And wouldn't it be great for you guys to have a big command center that saw all of, not just the fulfillment centers, but the end-to-end. Yes, Star Trek chair for you, says Ty Brady on it. These are ideas, I mean, people are having these ideas in the future, a little bit like NASA Mission Control, but more effective. And you know, in NASA Mission Control, each person is doing one little job, but in the command center of the future, one person does a lot more jobs, a lot of heterogeneous tasks. So we're actually doing this for trains. So the idea is more automation is going to come into rail. So we're going to need nationwide command centers to basically supervise manned, unmanned trains of the future. This is, you know, drone delivery, something that you've heard a lot about. We're also working on in the world of the drones that are not just delivering, but doing passenger aircraft. They're going to have to be new command centers that oversee that in addition to air traffic control. And of course, what's the next big thing coming? I'm actually working really hard to start a whole new command center capability here in North Carolina, where North Carolina basically sits as a command center for driverless car testing, to start putting them on the road and testing these with rapid reaction teams to find out how and where and when we can start integrating cars on the road. Another really quick thing, I won't spend too much time other than to say we have a big effort thinking about how humans understand technology, explainable AI, explainable machine learning. This is really hard. My own students don't understand machine learning. I myself, every time my student is briefing me on a machine learning project, we probably spend the first half hour just trying to clarify language and definitions. And so if it's a problem for people who are doing it day to day, I can promise you it's a problem worldwide. I consult with a lot of companies, and I think that most companies abuse the terms big data, machine learning, artificial intelligence. They don't really understand them. And if we can't understand what's going on in these black box reasoning systems, then it's hard to make actionable decisions on it. But in terms of driverless cars and transportation systems, it's even more hard to certify these systems if we don't understand fundamentally what the algorithms are doing underneath the hood. So I think this is probably one of the biggest growth areas that you're going to see in machine learning, is how to explain it. Last but not least, in terms of why should you care about all of this? So these are the latest research and development numbers of different industries that I thought you would be would like to see. So this is how effectively how much money is being poured into R&D in the various industries right now. And so in the green, you've got aerospace and defense. In the red are automotive, blue IT, and then energy. And so when I show these numbers, you know, the first thing that you should understand is, I think it blows people's mind that the automotive companies right now are outspending the aerospace and defense industry 3-1 on driverless car tech, and that's primarily for driverless cars. So there's three times as much research going on in the automotive world than the aerospace and defense industry. There's 10 times as much going on in the IT world. And that, and Amazon and the companies that you hear about, they are in the blue, right? So that just shows you there is a, I call it the space race of the 1960s is robotics. It's artificial intelligence. It's how to develop these systems. Energy, I mean, they're really not even on the map in terms of, you know, where's the future coming? The future is definitely coming in IT and automotive, and it's in some case aerospace and defense. But all this research that you hear about flying cars, where, and drones and Amazon, does that fit under the green or does that fit under the blue? What do you think? It's under the blue. So even now we're starting to realize that what we had thought as aerospace and defense is actually now really starting to slide more towards IT companies for commercial use, which is good because it means it's for the world. All right, with that, I'm out of time. And